Amen. Amen. Life is worth living. Because he lives. In other words, I can't see myself living without him. Oh, yes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. As we thank God for the message. Through song. And how it touches our hearts and reminds us of various places and points in our lives. We thank God. We want to prepare now to hear our scripture reading. Our scripture reading this morning is taken from the book of Proverbs, a very familiar passage of scripture. Proverbs chapter 18, and I want to begin reading at verse number 7 and commence with verse number 21. When you found it, say, I got it. Still looking, say, I'm still looking. Proverbs chapter 18, I don't know if I said 8 or not, 18, verses 7 through 21. While you're looking for that, I want to share with you that there would be a mental health conversation on February the 1st at 6:30, and that's going to be on Zoom, and we'll send you out the announcements for that. I'm beginning to understand more and more that mental health is not becoming, but is a serious issue. And until we start having some conversations about this, we're not going to be as prepared as we possibly can to be the best that we can. And then I need you to RSVP two things for me. One is the Buds are having a Valentine's dance and paint party and that's February the 11th. And that's going to be in the gym. And we need you to RSVP for your bud so we'll know what that head count is. And then on February the 19th, we need you to RSVP the church. And that's for the Agape Luncheon. And we need you to do that by February the 16th. Do your reserve. And the proceeds for that will go to help our mission work in the church that we do through the church and conference. Now you should be at Proverbs 18. I'm reading from a King James version of the Bible. And these are the words that we shall find printed. A fool's mouth is his destruction, and his lips are the snare of his soul. The words of a gossiper are as wounds, and they go down into the innermost part of the belly. He also that is slothful in his work is brother to him that is a great waster. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into it and is safe. The rich man's wealth is his strong city. And as an high wall in his own conceit. Before destruction, the heart of man is haughty. And before honor is humility. He that answers the matter before he hears it, it is folly and shame unto him. The spirit of a man will sustain his infirmity, but a wounded spirit, who can deal with it? Who can bear it? The heart of the prudent getteth knowledge, and the ear of the wise seeketh knowledge. A man's gift maketh room for him and bringeth him before great men. He that is first in his own cause seemeth just, but his neighbor cometh and examines him. Call him to the carpet. The lot causes contentions to cease and parteth between the mighty. A brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city. And their contentions are like the bars of a castle. A man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth. And with the increase of his lips shall he be filled. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And they that love whichever one shall eat the fruit thereof. The word of God for the people of God. Glory be to God. It's time now that we turn our attention to the Lord in prayer. Have you ever heard that you have not because you didn't ask him? Have you heard the rumors that when you ask him and didn't believe it, he just didn't put no time in it? But he said, ask anything in my name, believing, my Father, well, he'll do that. Let a double-minded man think that he shall receive nothing from God. He's unstable in all his ways. In other words, you can't go back and forth. Either you're going to believe it or you're going to doubt it. Don't confuse God on what you want done. So if you want it, ask him for it. And if you ask him for it, believe him that he can do it. Let us take this opportunity to pray. Lord God, we come this morning with a thank you. We open up singing, thank you for all that you've done for us. We mean that. Because we know that if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, we really don't know where we would be. Your love amazes us. When we search the scripture, it says that for God so loved whatever our name is, that you sent Jesus to save him. And not only save him, but give him the gift of eternal life. We thank you for loving us so much that you wanted to rescue us from our own conceit and ill wills and selfish choices. Thank you that you saw we were truly in a mess. And it's through the miracle birth of Jesus and death and resurrection that we are saved here today. We lay at your feet this morning the things that have kept us up all night. We lay at your feet the thing that came to mind this morning when we woke up and it was unresolved, unsettled, nudging at us still. We lay it at your feet. And we want to say to you what the two blind men said, Son of David, have mercy on us. We're asking you to help us. Because you will not confusion to us, but you will peace. So we ask you to send us your peace. We pray this morning for the things that are out of order in our lives, that you, O God, would order our steps. Help us to recognize that your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. And if we're going to find our directions, we're going to have to get in your word and find where you're trying to direct us. Help us, O God, to endure suffering as a good soldier. Help us to dismiss the thought that we are too good to suffer and too righteous to have any problems. But let us know that we don't go through anything alone, because you promised you would be with us. And you meant in the good as well as in the bad. We lift our hearts to you because everything else belonged to you. Our clothes, our food, our shelter, our cars, our jobs, all that belong to you. But it has to be our choice to give you our hearts. And I'm asking you right now that as we lift our hearts, and those of us who lift our hearts, would you, oh God, do for us and in us what the potter does with the clay? Would you shape and mold and help us to be what you want us to be? Oh, and if you find anything there that's not pleasing, would you, oh God, shave that out? Would you extract that from us? That thought that we had that is not right, the thought that we had that is about vengeance and unforgiveness that would cause us to be bitter, would you get that thought out of us? The plans that we have for folly and for self-contentment, that thing that has nothing to do with anybody else except our gratification. Would you take that thing out of our mouth and out of our plans? Would you, oh God, hear our thoughts and that which is impure? Would you transform it by conviction? Would you transform it by convincing? And would you transform it by letting us know that, God, we don't have to be conformed to those things, but we can be renewed, oh God, by our minds. We pray right now that you would make us over, and if we fail, make us over, and if we fail, make us over, and if we fail, make us over and over and over again. These children we call ours, we lift them to you right now. There's so much going on in our world that we can't control. We send them out in the midst of a COVID pandemic. We send them out in the midst of a world that is angry and bitter and looking to do harm without cause and doesn't make a difference if they know them or not. We send our children out in the midst of drunk drivers and people texting and talking and being distracted with their phones and other things. We send them out trusting them in the hands of other folk. But before they get to the teacher's hand, the driver's hand, before they get to the school's hand, we want to put them in your hand, oh God, and say they are yours. Set your hedge up around them like you did with Job's kid. And we make our offering this morning for them, that there may be some things that have occurred in their lives by thought, word, and deed that we may not be mindful of. But we pray today, wash them and wash them and wash them. Because our lives are models and example for them. Help us to be more conscious of what we say do in their presence. You ask us to put on self-control, so much so that you said that even when we know it's okay, but if it offends a brother, to put on restraint. So help us to live our lives other than ourselves. We pray your image today. Not like Superman going into a phone booth. Not like Spider-Man with the costume. But we pray your image in our speech and in our mannerism, in our conduct, that we may be found faithful. So we pray today, 428 West Northside Drive, get your glory out of us. Be glorified in us. We say yes to your will. We say yes to your way. And God, if trouble comes like it came to Job, we'll say, naked we came into this world and naked we shall return. The Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. But one thing we want to sign off on is saying, blessed be the name of the Lord. Because we know that if you did it before, you can do it. You can do it again. Hear our prayer and answer us. Cause our plans to succeed. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Amen.
There are some things. I may not know. There are some places I can't go, but I am sure of this. One thing, yes, God is real, for I can feel him in my soul. Sing it with me. And yes, God is real, real in
All right. Bless him at all times. Amen. How many of you are excited on the Lord's Day? Yeah, excited on the Lord's Day. Amen. I want you to turn with me to Proverbs 18, verse 20 and 21. While you're turning, we've been talking about in this series about being resilient. And today we continue in that series about being resilient, having resilience over resolutions. And you don't have to go and plan something new if you just complete what you started with. And I just believe in a season and time in which we live that God allows things to come up so that he and others will know where you stand. It's crazy how pre-pandemic, how much faith we had. And oh, how we love Jesus. And during the pandemic, we allowed fear to creep in and do all kind of crazy things. Do you know there are some people feel more safe at a basketball game than they do in a sanctuary? Some people feel more safe at a football game than they do in a sanctuary. Yeah. Yeah. I was sharing with a pastor while you find that. I'm just going to use a little dialogue time. I was sharing with a pastor yesterday that we can't get in a position that we judge our members because they like football. And they'll take a chance on not giving COVID at a football game and more convinced that they'll get it at church than they will at a football game. I said, we can't judge them. This is the reason that we've been called to preach and to teach. That's why we're shepherds, to love on them still, because they're gonna make decisions like that. And I said, don't be shocked. They've been making decisions like this all the time. When football season comes, people go ghost at church. Yeah. Watch Super Bowl Sunday. How many people? Because they got to get ready for the Super Bowl. And they convince themselves, oh, if I just miss one Sunday, it ain't going to hurt nothing. We tell ourselves a lot of things that make sense. But I had to say to the pastor, we can't judge them. We got to love them through this. And they'll come around. They will. They'll come around. I want us to know that God is calling us to courage. Let me change it. God is calling us to unwavering faith. Believe what you can't see. Try something you've never tried before. Yeah. One thing that I'm learning in this COVID variant is I gotta trust him. I'm learning that I gotta trust him. Man, just when you think that you out, some other name pop up. So I'm just saying, Lord, help me trust you more. Yeah. Y'all there now. Oh, yes, you are. Proverbs 18, 20 20 and 21, and then I want to share with you a passage as well from Luke 6:45. So you're going to have to indulge me a little bit today, okay? Ooh, my goodness. Here's the word. 20. A man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips shall he be filled. Can I translate that real quick? My stomach shall get what my mouth is saying. And the more I keep talking about it, the more I'm going to be filled with it. But hear ye, hear ye, hear ye. Death and life is in the power of the tongue. Death and life, you have authority to speak. And they that love death is going to eat the fruit of it. Those that love life is going to get the fruit of that. Luke 6:45 says, oh, a good man. Yes, sir. Not an average man. And not every man. A good man, out of the good treasure of his heart, bringeth forth that which is good. Check the comparison. And an evil man, out of the evil treasure of his heart, bringeth forth that which is evil. Say what you want to. A grape is a grape. A pear is a pear. A lemon is a lemon. Just above that, Luke said that a tree shall be known by the fruit that it bears. It goes on to say, for of the abundance, somebody say a heap. For out of a heap of his heart. That's what he gonna say. If he eating a whole lot of junk, he gonna say a whole lot of junk. If he eating a whole lot of Laffy Taffy, he gonna give you a whole lot of Laffy Taffy. But if he eating greens, Brussels sprouts, broccoli, beans, baked chicken, lightly seasoned, oatmeal, oh, you're going to get a solid, solid word. I want to talk about this morning a question for all of us. Are you listening to yourself? Yes, sir. Are you listening to yourself? I want you to know and us to understand that we don't have to introduce ourselves to anybody. We are made known in the way that we communicate. Put people in a room with a problem and listen to them, and you'll discover a whole lot about their perception, about their faith, and where they possibly are heading. Most people like to complain about a problem with no resolutions. Like to jump in and add and heap on to, did you know? Well, I'm thinking, I figure. Absent from the conversation is what I discern, how the Lord is leading. Well, to be more objective, to give the benefit of the doubt. It appears that Even Christians love foolishness. Like to have their hands muddy with foolery, being busy from house to house. Have you for a moment played back your conversation that you had with someone just that hour to listen to what your contributions were to that conversation? I'm going to preach today whether you go with this or not. I'm preaching this. Have you played back that conversation just to discover what kind of person you are and not get mad with other folk because they call what they see? See, some of us have been called messy, busybody, gossipers, naysayers, doubters, truth breakers. And we were offended, and people were simply labeling what they heard, what they witnessed. Now, let me go ahead and say this, because just because the day you had that kind of day doesn't mean that's who you are every day. I know what you're thinking. Well, how in the world am I going to have fun if I don't tell white lies and tell jokes? How am I going to really be a happy person if I can't talk about somebody in between? And if it's true, is there any harm? The question really is, why are you investing your time there? Is it to help or is it a harm? Oh, if our moments are accounted for, if our time in this earth, God has given us, he's going to hold us accountable for it. Should we not be using it wiser? If our time is limited and we don't know how many days we're going to live, should not we be giving ourselves to things that really matter to us and less to things that don't have anything to do with us? Are you listening? The last time your boss gave you an evaluation, or did you reject it? Are you listening to the last group of text messages that you sent this morning? The context, the content, the who. When you play back your moment about tomorrow, what are you saying? Do you believe that it's going to be better then than it is now? We have to understand that our words are spirits. And what we say comes alive. That's if the scripture is right. What we say come alive. In front of you is a piece of paper on some pews. I need you to pick those papers up. When you pick them up, I want you to stand up. And I want you to do a Vanna White. Turn them around. Hold them up and turn them around. Most often our conversation sounds like these words. I'm sick as a dog. Guess what? If you keep saying it, roof, 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 roof. You getting ready to get sick. When people talk to you and you lack confidence in yourself, you say, well, little old me. Well, people don't ever, they always looking down on the small folk. Well, you've been advertising little old me. And if you've been advertising little old me, what should my perception of you be? So why should I think bigger of you than you are presenting about yourself? Tammy Turn, to me. Y'all about to drive me crazy. Who got that much control? Who have you given that much power to? That you would allow them to drive you crazy. That won't happen for me. Sidelining and watching everybody else on the escalator going up, looking back at you waving, and you trying to figure out where they think they're something. They are somebody. And you're somebody too if you just step forward to the escalator. If you don't know how to get on it, just squat, sit. You're laying. I can't. And before you did the T, you already told us that you could. But because you stretched yourself farther, you spoke doubt over faith. I'm broke. Who in here broke? You ain't broke. Not if your father got money. I hope that you are understanding and having some revelation how we're talking every day really manifests itself and brings us to a place where we become sick in our body and even depressed in our spirit. Because you keep telling yourself every day, I'm broke. You keep telling yourself, I'm sick as a dog. You keep telling yourself, y'all about to drive me crazy. You keep looking at yourself in the mirror and saying, little old me. I can't read that one, Sandra. Turn it towards me. If you say that y'all about to drive me crazy, if you're looking at that one, that things never happened to me. You keep saying, I can't read that one way back there. I can't read that one way over there. But I want you to give me that one, Brown. I'm sick and tired. These words get in your spirit. It gets in your fiber. It gets in your being. And the next time something come up, you begin to become more exhausted and more depressed. Not because of what they did to you, but because of what you've been speaking. There's an expression that is used in some circles that no matter how hard, watch this, no matter how hard it get, I'm going to pull the hood and get to it. In other words, that it doesn't make a difference what's required of it. I'm getting ready to dig deep in this one. I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to faint. I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to let it go. I'm going to turn every rock and every stern, every turn. I'm going to turn every corner until the light comes on for me. How we got to live with that kind of determination, and we got to speak those kind of languages. When people come to you and say, child, I'm my only child of God. Listen, I want to tell you something. You ain't going to believe this. I don't know if I believe it or not. Let me hear it first. Don't speak into my gates and let the preference of your statement bring me to a place where I can't rise above it. I wish I could say that again. We ought to learn to tweak it before we speak it. Y'all ain't hearing the preacher today. We ought to learn to tweak it before we speak it. In other words, if it don't sound good to me, then maybe I need to do what they call a spell check and a grammar check. Can you imagine, Lord have mercy, Jesus, can you imagine the words that you put in the atmosphere hanging over your head? Next time God drop a promise, that word in the atmosphere say, I can't. And who is the author of these words? Satan. The scripture, that we're told that he's the author of confusion. He wants to get in our minds. He wants to get in our heads. What I'm trying to get us to do today, and it's being resilient, is not leave this service talking about I'm going to communicate better. No, leave this service saying I better check myself. And when I hear myself talking crazy, I'm going to check my own self and say, wait a minute, give me an opportunity to go ahead and do a spell check and a grammar check. Give me a chance to reorganize this sentence, because I know I told you that it ain't never been done before, but I believe that God is a God of first time. I believe that when the earth was void and it didn't have no
no shape or form that I got a record over is in Genesis 1 that say God began to speak, and God began to speak and things began to happen, and the things that God spoke about, they became visible. How do you know they became visible? If the Bible was recorded way back then, why is it that I see the things that God talked about way back then happening still alive today? I need to check myself. When I said that I don't feel good, well, let me shake myself. I don't feel good, but I believe it's going to be all right. I'm just in a bad place right now, but I know that it's going to get better. In other words, use complete sentences.
What I'm trying to get us to understand, and even Gary Adams, I'm trying to get him to understand that, listen, you have more authority than you've been letting yourself have. You got more power than you've been using. And then I'm going to tell you what, if you don't use it, it's just going to waste. And the devil is laughing at you saying, you got the boat, you got the wrench to take those nuts off that wheel. Ha, 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 ha. You won't even use it. The words are in your belly, but you won't even speak them. Are you listening to yourself? I hope that at this point, at least you, while I've been talking, you've been hearing yourself talk about, well, I don't think that I can get that promotion. Why not? I'm going to tell you one of the most interesting things to me. Go out there on the state job website and go look for, y'all can have a seat, and look for a job out there and watch that job tell you that you got to have a PhD and 2 years of experience. Then the next thing is or. A master's degree and 4 years experience. Then or. A bachelor's degree and 6 years experience. Watch this. And or. A high school diploma or GED equivalent with 12 years of experience. Baby, God is saying, listen, there is opportunity according to your faith. There's room if you want to grab hold to it. I'm the or. I ain't got everything everybody else got, but or is somewhere in the description for me. First thing I want to usher you into when we look at the text, that I want you to understand that we have to realize that when we're asking ourselves, what are we listening to what we're saying? You got to know the potential of your instrument. You got to know your instrument's potential. In other words, you got to know what your mouth can and will do. James says that the tongue is crazy, man. It'll set the world on fire. If you ain't careful, you'll burn up everything God bless you with. And you ain't struck a match. All you did was just open your mouth. How can I burn the things that God blessed me with? You'll keep on saying, I, me, my. Let it burn. What we have to realize is this. We got to understand the potential of this thing. Say this with me. I am subject to say about anything. That's the truth. I want you to say that because that's a confession. And most of us won't make that confession in public. We won't make it out loud. That I'm subject to say anything. You saying, oh, not me. Oh, Peter proved to us, if you press all the right buttons at the right time and put me in the right location, man, I'll say some stuff I thought I would deliver from. I'm telling you, I'll use some languages that I had buried and put 6 foot under, but I didn't realize that the rain had came and beat a hole in it. In other words, never say never. Always say the Lord being my help. We have to realize, watch this, because I want you to look at the verses that we're introducing to us. Knowing the instrument, our instrument's potential is this. The words of a man's mouth. I'm at verse number 4. The words of a man's mouth. Watch how it's described in here. It says, are as deep waters. The words of a man's mouth is as deep water. The wellspring of wisdom as a flowing brook. Now listen to this. You got to realize that, listen, what you say is like an anchor. Why should you guard your speech? Because it's weighty. Check out verse number 7. A fool's mouth is his destruction.
God could give you something and you could talk yourself right back out of it. God could do something for you and you could lose it just because of this instrument. Then verse number 8, the words of a gossiper or as a wound. It says talesbearer in your Bible. But if you got a translation Bible, at the bottom it'll say gossiper. The words of a gossiper are as wounds. In other words, if you don't know the truth, shut up. If you weren't there, mind your business. If you don't know, don't be afraid to say, I don't know. And it goes on to say, listen, and go down into the innermost part of the belly. Listen, what is described here by Solomon is this. Thank you for putting that on the screen. What Solomon's saying right here, you're talking about hitting rock bottom in your belly. Gossip. Because what happened was gossip. People that trust us trust what we say, and we lie. What I'm trying to urge all of us to do today is be more conscious of the things that we say. Can I go back to verse number 7, if you don't mind? Verse number 7, if you don't mind. A fool's mouth is his destruction. Did nobody do it? Quit blaming the devil. Have y'all heard the joke about the devil standing outside the church? Weeping and crying and bawling and whatnot. And the Lord said, hey, Satan, what's wrong with you? He said, I'm fucking up in there lying on me. And the devil made me. The devil ain't made. The devil enticed and you took it. He baited you. You bit it. He's out there weeping and bawling. And God, what's up with you? Man, I'm fucking in there lying. Not my fault. Second thing you need to realize is that we have to be careful about what we put into the atmosphere. The first point was acknowledging what this instrument is capable of. You have to know that you can say things that will set a course on fire. But you also can put out fires. One of the things that I tell people all the time, if I know you, ain't nobody gonna tell me anything about you. I will defend you. I might be wrong, but I'm going to hold you up until I find the truth. Ain't nobody going to drop no anything on me. No, Lordy. No. Somebody come to me, man, them people at Cathedral, I'm going to listen. Man, them people at Cathedral, I tell you the truth, man. You think they did, they think they're that. I'm going to say, well, the people over there, where you at? Let's talk about, listen to me. It's not eye for eye. Let's just talk about human behavior. My folk is just like other folk. Yeah. Yeah. We have to understand that. Know what this is capable of. We got to use our words more wisely. We got to be more constructive with what we're saying, because we've been admonished through Proverbs that our words have power. Say that. Our words have power. And I'm going to say this too, and I want you to say this with me. My words have consequences. We need to understand that. Now, moving into the second point, we got to be careful what we put into the atmosphere. Because if our words are activated, and when we speak them out loud, they're activated, we got to be careful what kind of atmosphere we want around us. I'm the only person in here. No, I'm not. But I was about to say, I'm the only person here listening to just about what anybody is saying and look like I believe what they're saying. I do that because you want to give people the benefit of the doubt. But watch this. Imagine an atmosphere where you walk into it and it feels cold. Think about when you walk into an atmosphere and people start treating you cold, but everybody's laughing before you get there, right. And as soon as you pull the glass door open, the room goes shh, and everybody just go back to work. It's not those 15, 25 people that you work with. Folk can't say she messy.
Watch this. Let me go back to the text, because you don't trust what I'm saying. The text says this: watch what you put in the alpha spirit, because we shall reap what we say. You got a scripture that says you reap what you sow, but you shall reap what you say. Watch this. It says that in this particular portion of it, in the atmosphere, we have to realize that a man's belly, if it's going to be satisfied with the stuff I put in the air, I better pay attention to my atmosphere. I got to watch what I'm putting up there. Now, notice what the text is telling us. It's not talking about my neighbor. The text is talking about me and you. Now, let me tell you what happens with this. If you read it, I can tell you what happens with this. You have the wherewithal to change your atmosphere. You can change a room. You can change a room. That room could be dark. It could be cold. That room could be, when you walk in there with your spirit, pow. And I'm not talking about the spirit. I'm talking about the spirit. Mama, forgive me, but I have walked in parties. You know, hey, oh. Well, Gary's here. We get ready to live up and get ready to go down. Yeah, man. What y'all been up to? What y'all been doing before I got here? Let's go, let's go, let's go. Not that spirit. You got any more of that in my trunk? Excuse me, mama. Not this spirit, but this spirit. Be guilty of being a positive person. Be guilty of believing in people. Be guilty of giving people at least some hope. Even if a person speaks doubt, cover it with hope. One of the things that Bishop Leek preached about yesterday is that when you may convict people, but don't leave them broken. They may have done the worst thing that they could ever do, but always build people back up and let them know that you can do better. Go try again. That's what I mean by you have to pay attention to what you put into the atmosphere, because I want you to know that when you are gone, your children got what you left behind. I don't care what that word or language was. Your children got what you left dangling in the air. And if my belly is going to be satisfied with the fruit of my lips, I'm going to tell y'all, I like pineapple. I like strawberry. I like grapes. I want that thing that will be good to my stomach and not detrimental. Can I use some graphic language? I don't want to speak stuff that's going to tear my stomach up. I don't want to have stuff in the atmosphere that would interrupt my life. That stuff that would cause God to pump the brakes. Because if God gave us a word that I watch over my word to perform it, don't you know God is listening for his word? God is listening for his word. The last point is this, that you shall get what you sow, or what you say. Pay attention, watch this. He says, death and life is in the power of the tongue. And then can I get that last scripture back up there from Luke 6:45? He says that death and life is in the power of tongue. I want you to know that you got to stop speaking ICU language. You got to stop talking like you're in intensive care. If you don't know, I don't know right now. If you ain't got it, I ain't got it right now. If you can't see it, I just can't see it right now. Folk gonna say to you, you're changing. Yes. You're talking different. Yes. Because I'm looking for greater in my life. I'm looking for better in my life. God got too many promises out there that could be mine if I just speak the right language. If I just say the right words. That 45 says this, a good man. I can't tell you whether you're good or not.
But he said that the good man of the good treasure of his heart, which means, listen, people will judge you by your behavior, by your language, by your conduct, by your mannerism. People know what's in your heart. Because if you foul, it ain't gonna take but a few minutes. I've heard people talk. I said, they ain't asked me to be excused. I said, I gotta step out of this. Because too much negativity, it suffocates me. Too much complaining, it sucks my spirit. So he says that out of a good treasure, which means this, out of a good treasure of his heart, watch this, I got something to offer. Do you see that? Because if you bring it forth, you gotta have it. You can't bring nothing out that ain't in you. We gotta stop thinking that we're empty. Watch this. Well, I can't pray like Reverend Adam because you ain't Reverend Adam. I can't pray like everybody else. You don't wanna pray like everybody else. You wanna pray your language where God understands what you are communicating about and that you get the results that you got. Now, let me tell y'all something. Arthur Brown and I ain't got the same problem, but both of us are fathers and husbands. We ain't got the same problem. And he ain't praying my prayer, and I ain't praying his prayer. But God answers our prayers. He ain't got the same problem with his boys that I had with mine. No, no, no. But when he talk about his children, God is listening to what Arthur got to say. When Arthur go to God and say, God, listen, you gave me these children and you blessed my house with these children. And I gave these children back to you. And I trust that you're going to bring these children up and that you're going to keep them safe and that you're going to provide for them, that you're going to protect them, that you're going to open up doors for them. God say, Arthur, I hear what you're saying, because Arthur say, that's what your word told me. Gary Adams might say, oh, thou great Jehovah, our God eternal, I'm praying for little Gary that you would come and see about him in a time of emergency, that God, you will awaken him to know the power of your grace and your might. God say, that's his personality. Prayer answered. You got to stop praying like everybody else, because there are some things I'm desperate about that I use fragmented sentences. I said, God, help me. Lord, have mercy. Oh, Jesus, I ain't making no complete sentences, but you know I'm in trouble and you know I'm bad off. And I just need you to understand that if you don't help me, I'm about to drown and sink. So I need you to come on in. Sometimes my nose is running and my eyes are filled and I can't get a word out, and all I'm saying is abba, abba, abba. And God said, I got you, boy. I understand where you're going and I know what you're saying. You can't be like me, because you're not in my story, you're not in my struggles, nor do you know my pain. But God answers us and he meets us where we are. So you got to put it in the atmosphere. You got to say, it's going to change, it's going to change, it's going to change. I need 6 volunteers real quick. It's going to change. I need you to come on with the front. I need 6 volunteers. Give me 2, 2, and 2. I need 2 out of this session, 2 out of this session, 2. I said, listen, the longer you take, the longer I'm going to preach. 2 out of this session, 2 out of this session, and 2 out of this section. There's 1, 2. Asia, can you come help him tie these up? Who else know how to tie real fast? Just, you up here now. I got 2, 4, 6. I got those. Flea to come help him to tie. Tie it around their wrist. It got tape on it. Yeah. So pull it. Put all of them out. Yeah. Let just, do I need to come help? Okay. If you let them go up in the air on their own. If you let them go up in the air on their own, you don't have to pull it like that. Well, pull it like that. Okay. Pull it like that. Come on, I need somebody else to come help tie. Because we're going to move real fast. Come on, help tie. Don't be an observer, a spectator. Be a participator. Don't let these go to the ceiling because I can't get them down. Tie them to your wrist and bring it all the way to your wrist. Bring it all the way down to your wrist. Once it's tied on your wrist, no, let it have the full expansion. Let it have the full expansion. The full expansion. But tie it to their wrist. And when you've got it tied to your wrist, bring it down to secure it as close to your hand as you possibly can. Now, what I need you to understand is this right here. That what we're getting ready to talk about is that our words, what it looks like when we begin to speak our words. Okay, because I'm a very visual person, and I have to have concepts that helps me to understand, okay, God, this is what you're trying to say. Because the preacher been preaching for a whole hour, and I still ain't got what he said. All I heard him say is, are you listening to what you're saying? So I'm just trying to say, God, what does he mean? Are you listening to what you're saying? I'm saying, do you hear yourself talking, and do you realize what's in the atmosphere, what's over your head? Do you realize that what's going on in your life is an end result of what you're speaking about your life? Because when you believe in yourself, guess what? You're going to do things that show that you believe in yourself. When you think things are going to turn around, you start talking like things are getting ready to turn around. Wait, baby, it ain't over yet. That's the kind of language you use. God ain't finished yet. Those are the languages you, the types of terms that you begin to use. Okay, tomorrow, today. Are y'all there? Did it break? If it broke, if that one broke, do this for me. Take what you have and tie that to her hand and give me the difference. Then I'm going to show you something. It should be one left. No, that one doesn't have a string. So I should have six of y'all. Should be seven balloons all together. It's six. So this one should be mine. So tie me up. You hold on to that. Don't you go nowhere. You're going to be, don't tie it too tight. Yeah, well, that's okay. Tie however you tie. That's good. Just tie. Okay, now, everybody bring their balloon like this. Now, this is what I want you to see. This is so simple because I was like, Lord, you know, how can I get people to understand that when they speak, what happens? I want you to know that this is what's going on. Jesus Christ, what am I doing? This is what's going on. You say, oh, I'm a Bible believer. Man, your words is just on the page. Hold your hand up like this. It's on the page. Everybody, do me. It's on the page. It's on the page. You got it, but it's just on the page. Watch me, y'all. When I start to believe it, and then when my faith grows, just let it up just a little bit. Just, you believe in, you trust in him. You've been sick, but you pray. He gonna heal. Just open your hand. Just go do what it do. Yeah. That job, everybody being promoted but you, but you've been there training everybody getting promoted. Uh-huh. Are you with me? What you're looking at is, I got the word. But the word is just words to me. What happens is that when you launch faith with the word, the word begins to lift you higher. Let him go. Don't be afraid. It's tied to you, baby. Don't be afraid. The word is tied to you. Don't be afraid. Listen. The reason I did it on different levels, because sometimes we are afraid of where God is trying to take us. And when it looked like we are going high because we are afraid of heights, we started to put a ceiling on God. God said, no, keep on trusting me. Keep on believing me. Keep on watching me. Don't you put no boundaries on me. And you watch God do different things. Well, you're saying, hold on, brother. Their word they have, but they're at different levels. Oh, yes, that's true. We're all on different levels. We have to understand what the Bible says. Our gift make room for us. How much room can you squeeze? I got a whole lot. I got a little bit. I got some. And oh, my God, I'm all way back up there. But guess what happened? It's because I got the word. Now, let me tell you what I did with that word. When I got the word in my life, what I did, Elise, you got to say this. I am a lender. Oh, yeah, you're tired of being broke. So what you're saying is getting ready to be some transformation in my life. I am a lender. In other words, God, I can't lend until you give. I can't lend till you sin. Oh, yeah, see, for folk that's tired of being broke, you got to realize that your language got to help you transition. You got to understand your language got to get you over the humps. Oh, yeah, you've been reading your word and you've been wanting some things in your life. And you're talking about, girl, what you going to do? What I'm going to do? He will. Not me. He will. Y'all ain't hearing me today. Y'all got you standing there. What I need you to understand is this, that before God, come on, Asia, help me here. Before God, take it back. Hey. He'll add more to it. God is not slack concerning his promises. Oh no, a little bit more faith, a little bit more God. A little bit more faith, a little bit more God. Where will faith take you? Amen. Where will you allow faith to take you?
Amen.
You've been talking about promises and what you're going to do and what you believe in God for. What's your response? Girl, wait a minute. Let me just tell you. No, no, no. Your response is, it shall be. How many of y'all been talking back to the devil like this? Oh, I'm so tired. No, devil. It shall be. I got so many stumbling blocks in my way, but it shall be. I am whosoever. Everywhere in the Bible, they don't put a name. God opened that window for me. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. I'm the whosoever that God is talking about. I have no respect of person. So if I can conceive his word, believe his word, I can receive his promises. Y'all ain't hearing me today. What make you think it's going to happen for you? I'm whosoever. Who you think you are? Whomsoever. Whomsoever in a whatsoever situation. Who are you? In a whatsoever. I'm a whomsoever in a whatsoever. But I got a God that will live and rule forever. Girl, you big. Real big. And you know what all that happened to her? How she got big? Is she stopped saying, I can't. I can do all things through Christ. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. In other words, if he wake me up, I can. If he let me breathe, I can. If he opens up a door, I can. If he let me open my mouth, I can. Y'all ain't hearing the preacher today. Y'all ain't hearing the preacher today. What does one say? I am the head. And I'm not talking about a head of a household. And not the tail. I'm not going to be in the back always. The only way I'm in the back right now, because I understand that God got to clean some stuff up and move some folk out. Because when God take us into Canaan land, we go into houses that we did not build. We go to vineyards that we did not plant. We move into cities that we didn't have to do any infrastructure to. But God got the land ready for me. So I don't mind standing in line for my promotion. I don't mind waiting, because I ain't got nothing but time on my side anyhow. I've been praying and I've been fasting. I've been reading. I've been doing my devotion. And I've been trusting God. So all I got time to do is wait on God, because I know that every step of the way, he's going to take me to another level. I know that every time trouble comes, it's just the devil trying to block my progress. And I'm still speaking today that I am the head. I'm the head of my troubles. I'm over all of the things that the devil tried to plant in my way to make me feel that I am defeated. I am the head, and I take authority over the things in my life that does not line up according to the will and the word of God. I declare today that the word of God is true, and the devil is a liar. I promise today that as the deer panted for the water, so does my soul long after thee. Some of y'all are saying, I'm not at a place of elevation, but I got his word. There are some balloons in front of you. Grab them if they're in front of you. You want one? I give you mine, mama. I take yours. You don't mind. My blessings, listen, I'm the seed of you. Sometimes we got a word. And sometimes, because we don't believe, feel like I'm losing weight in here. Sometimes because I don't believe. Who that? It don't make a difference. Listen, watch this. Sometimes I don't believe. I got a word. There's a passage that say, have your word. Have I? So when I walk out, So when I move around, this morning while I was sitting up in my office, the Lord kind of revealed to me the balloon. If you believe that the pull of God is always up, then the word got to stay up. And if the word pulls me forward, then my motion for my balloon ought to keep on going forward. I got to keep up with what God is leading me to. When I fan and wave, worship and praise, I don't know what he's going to do next, but I got to stay with it. I got to stay with the word. Oh, man have fables, and they have all kind of portions and rhyme, but I got to stay with the word. I don't know where he leads me, but I know where he leads me. I shall follow. It's on you. You got to stay with the word. I wonder, do I have somebody in the room today that got a promise that they want to trust God for? All you got to do is get the word in your possession and stay with the word the rest of your days. God will do just what his word says that he will do. You better pay attention to what you are saying, and you better start being more attentive about what you say, because God's eyes is on his word to perform it. Don't you tell me I can't, because I know I can. And when I believe I can, I go over all kind of obstacles. Stop letting folk putting ceilings on you. If you ain't got nothing but the word, watch this. Look up when you go outside. Tell me what's between you and heaven. If there ain't nothing between you and heaven, that's where your faith ought to be pulling you to. I ain't got no ceilings. I got a foundation, but I don't have any ceilings. I'm going just as high as I sense God is calling me. We're urged today by the boy Solomon to let us know that a man's belly is satisfied with his communication. We got to start looking at stuff. If people start asking us crazy questions, oh, Ishael, it's been a long time. Don't worry about that, Ishael. Well, how you know? Who are you supposed to be? Whosoever? I mean, quit playing with me. Whomsoever is my name. If you don't believe it, go in the Bible and look it up and see is whomsoever in the Bible. You find me there. And I'm trusting him. You see all these things going on? Whatever. Whatever. Because he's a God or whatever. There's a man that had leprosy, whatever. A woman had an issue of blood, whatever. A man that was paralyzed, whatever. A daughter that was on a dying bed, whatever. Two blind men, whatever. A man in the graveyard like a lunatic, whatever. I'm whomever for whatever. Gary Adams, how did you get there? I'm glad you asked me. If you look at the screens, at least I hope I'm on point. If you look at the screens, I'm going to tell you how to get there. You got to get this in you. Just give it a minute. You got to learn how to have some patience. Gary Adams, how do I get to that place where I'm getting the promises of God? 'Tis so sweet. It is so sweet to trust in Jesus. Just to take him at his word. Listen to what the next line say. Just to rest. Can I show you what rest look like? Just to rest. Just to rest. Just to rest. Every one of these positions put me in a place of vulnerability that I can't fall, but you will fall if you're not leaning on the on the right person. Just to rest upon his promise. Watch the next line. Just to know. I ain't talking about what nobody told you, what you read for yourself. Just to know, thus says the Lord. Give me the next line. It goes on to say, Jesus, how I trust him. I'm not worried about my pew member, my person. How I trust him. How I proved him, which means I've tried him, he did it. I tried him again, he did it. I tried him again, he did it. How I've proved him over and over. Now watch my next response. Jesus, precious Jesus. Oh, for grace, just to trust him more. What does that mean? It means that I'm in a place I've never been at before, but I know what he did last time. This is brand new to me, but to trust him more. Next one. Oh, I'm so glad. Have you seen my life, how it's been unfolding and changing and transforming because I trust him? Oh, I'm so glad I learned to trust him. Who is he? Precious Jesus, Savior, friend. Look at the name changes. If you need it, Jesus. If you need a Savior, if you need a friend. Oh, and I know that he is with me. What's your confidence? He'll be with me until when it's bad. He's with me till the end. Yes. Till the end. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus. Just to trust. I've been dealing with possessions. I've been dealing with blessings. Now I'm dealing with my sanctification. Oh, trust him, his cleansing blood. And in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing, cleansing flood. If I need to be baptized, if I need to be dipped, if I need to be washed, he'll make me over again. Next, yes! Tears sweet to trust in Jesus. Just from sin and self, I'm dying now since I've been cleansed. Y'all ain't seeing this. Just from sin and self to see. Just from Jesus simply taking life in rest, joy, and peace. My Lord. I think that should be close to the last one. That's the last one. The refrain. That's the verse. Watch this. Tis so sweet. Come on, Lisa. To trust in Jesus. Just to take him at his word. Come on, you need to be singing that one because that's where you're trying to go. Just to rest upon his promise. Just
to know, thus said the Lord.
Now here's the refrain.
Jesus. How I trust him.
Hey.
How I prove him more
and more.
Jesus, precious Jesus.
Oh.
For grace to trust him more.
Jesus. Come on, church, let's call him.
How I trust him.
For the sick child, for the sick body, for the depression, for the stress that's in your life. How I proved him
him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Oh, for grace to trust him more.
Y'all can have those if you want them. That's your sign that you've been to church and that you participated. That's your sign. I hope that what I've tried to show you, that you've gotten that I'm responsible for having his word and keeping his word alive in my life and expressing his word wherever I go, that God may reveal in me and reveal to me the awesomeness of who he is. I want to thank our viewers for sharing with us and being a part of this worship experience. I pray that this message has resonated with you, to let you know that you got to listen to what you're saying. And perhaps the situation of your life is because of the declarations you've made. And if you want your position and situation to change, then you got to change your communication. You got to not just depend on people around you, but you got to trust the man above you. And he's going to do the impossible stuff. He's going to do the impossible stuff. I was told years ago, if you can do it, then God is trusting you.
Yes.
But if you can't do it, then you need to be trusting him.
That's it. Right.
Y'all heard what I said? If you can do it, then he's trusting you. Yeah. But if you can't do it, you ought to be trusting him.
Right.
So we thank God. We're going to dismiss our virtual audience. Peace and blessings be unto you. May the grace of God be with you and remain with you in the peace of God. Forever and ever be yours. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And amen. Amen. All right. We are now, we're going to ask our officers to come. There's one more piece of this series left. And the last part of it is I'll be back. I'm bouncing back. We'll do that next week. I'm bouncing back. And we'll be done with this particular series. If you need an offer.